Okay, so let me explain the essence of the Osellager theorem, just the idea. Let me consider the trivial case, but which is the essence. Then the trivial case is the case multiplication of a random number. Mentioned you have the sequence of random number a1, a2, an, where this number, these are positive and distributed according to a certain probability distribution, smooth enough. Okay. And then you consider this problem. You take x of z, z n equal the product of this number. Okay. So you know the probability distribution of this stuff, very independent. And you wonder what happened when n go to infinity? This is the, okay, this is the divergence of the reason. What happened? So if you have to guess the behavior of this quantity when n is very large, okay? One temptation is say this is the average of a to n. This is wrong. This is not true. Okay. The behavior, the most probable behavior, the typical behavior, which happens with probability one, is that this go like exponential n, the log, the average or log of a. Why? In a more formal way, you say the limit of one over n z n go to this. Go to this with the probability one. Why? It's real because you just take this, perform the logarithm. You have the logarithm of Zn is sum of log of An. Okay. Then, since these are independent, even log is independent. And so, and if you divide by n, you invoke the law of the large number and you have this approach to log of a. And that's it. Okay? This is just trivial. It's just a trivial application of just trivial remark, trivial consequence of the law of large number. Now, the Osellek theorem is the same kind of result, but in highly non-trivial situation. The situation is the following. You have, now instead to have number, you have matrix. Let me call A1, A2, and so on. Okay. And let me define the B, N as the product in an ordered way. Huh? And then let me introduce the matrix, the transposal matrix, which is the A1 DAG, A2. And you wonder, the Osellek is about this. You take this matrix, you multiply this by this in such a way the matrix is symmetric. And then you wonder what happened when these go to infinite. Okay, now, just to do in a more precise way, let me take this quantity, okay? Which is, formally, this is the say I take z. This corresponds to the zn. Formally, zn is the same 1/2n. This go to log of a. This term. Okay. Now I consider this. Now this is a matrix. Now it is a matrix, and you wonder what happened when n go to infinity. So in this case, this quantity go to this with probability one. Okay, the Osellek theorem, which is absolutely non-trivial, but in the same spirit, the statement is when O go to infinity, approach to a certain matrix, let me call V, approach a certain matrix. Of course, this matrix, you can expect that the matrix depend of the exact sequence you have, okay? But But you see that in analogy with this, you had here this quantity, almost all the sequence approach to the same value. Even here, you have the same. All these things approach to the same matrix, which is independent from the specific sequence. This is the theorem. Okay, this is the theorem, which is in some sense is a generalization of this. This is trivial. Okay, this is not trivial at all. Okay, so from this fact, if you translate this in terms of the tangent vector, you have the Lyapunov exponent. Okay, why? Because so you have this, and this is certain. You have a certain matrix, and this matrix has some eigenvalue. Let me call alpha one, alpha two, and so on. And these are positive, of course, because it is because of this a real. And there are also some eigenvalue, some eigenvector. Let me call b one, b two, and so on. Now, the fact that there exists this asymptotic matrix, you can translate this stuff for the Lyapunov exponent. Now you have that with the notation of yesterday, Zn is equal to Bn at zero. Okay, now you take Zn modulo square. This is Zn. So this is Bn Z0, Bn Z0. You have this, okay? Now you see that appear this magic. Now, you want to understand 1 over n log of this stuff. Okay, but this is 1 over 2 n this quantity. Okay, so now you see, now you understand why is important that this is some limit. Okay, because this means that of course this depends of z0. Okay, and so now depend of the if z zero is perpendicular or not to the eigenvalue eigenvector of this matrix. So and you have the Lyapunov exponent. Okay, there exists the Lyapunov exponent, and the meaning is this one. Okay. This is the mathematical part without any proof, just to mention the theorem. Now, the method by Benettin et al. Carlo Benettin is a very wonderful mathematician, very kind person in Padua. He went in pension just a few years ago. He's a great gentleman. Not only a great scientist, but also a great gentleman. And Benettin et al. Actually, the first paper has been published on Physical Review, but is the first paper was, say, not very rigorous, just in the style of theoretical physicists. Some years later, it was a rigorous paper published in a very obscure journal, and the name is Meccanica. And in spite of the fact that this journal is completely unknown almost to everybody, the paper is very important. Okay, and the method is the following. So I discussed yesterday. So I discussed for maps, for maps or differential equation, there is no big difference. So in the case of map, map and ordinary differential equation. So in the case of map, we have something like that. X at time t plus one equal g of x time t. For differential equation, we have x dot x dot equal f of x. Tangent vector is written this way. Where A is ij. Here is z dot equal A the same. Then the method is the following. You have this equation for the evolution of the system, and then you have the equation for the evolution of tangent vector. Imagine that you want to the system is dimension n. N is the dimension of the system. So for example, in the case of an unmapped 2, or in the case of the Lorentz system is 3, and so on. Okay, now the algorithm is the following. So you at t equals 0, you start with the zeta 1, zeta 2, zeta n 0, and these are orthonormal vector, okay? Zeta I 0, zeta j 0, zeta, okay? Are mutually orthonormal. Then each of these evolve according to this equation, this or this, okay? up to a certain time t equal tau, okay? This evolve this way. This evolve, and after this evolution, I consider, let me call alpha 1 equal alpha 1 tau equal the modulus of z 1 tau. Okay. And let me call alpha 2 tau the following quantity. So this is z 1, this is z 2. And I look at this area. Okay. And this, let me call this half 2. Now let me call alpha, half 3, the volume when determined by zeta 1, zeta 2, zeta 3, and so on. Okay. Then after this, I perform a Grass-Mitt orthonormalization. Okay, so I rescale this. I take this, I rescale. Let me call W. W1Z is just Z1 normalized, divided by alpha 1. For W2, is a vector which is perpendicular to this one. The W3 is perpendicular to W1 and W2, and so on, the orthonormalization. Okay? And then I reconsider this and restart again, and repeat again. Okay? So I look at the evolution. After a certain time, tau, I perform a Grass-Mitt orthonormalization, I compute this quantity, and then go on. So then I perform this, I iterate this a long time. And what happened? That from this quantity, alpha 1, alpha, computed at time tau to tau and so on. So I have that the lambda 1 is the limit m go to infinite, 1 over m tau, sum of log of alpha one j from 1 to m j tau. Okay, if I want lambda 2, that lambda 1 plus lambda 2 is the same, but here I have alpha 2. And so on. So if you want lambda 1 plus lambda 2 plus lambda k, this is the same stuff with here, I have just alpha k. So this means that I can compute all the characteristics of the Lyapunov exponent. There is no problem. So it's just long because the computer time increases. So if I want one, practically you have to double the time. If you want two, you have factor three, and so on. And so you see that it's not possible to compute the second without the computation of the first. And you cannot compute the third without the computation of the first and the second, and so on. Mm-hmm. And this is the method. So this method was in the history of the dynamical system was extremely important. It was really a turning point of the history of the dynamical system, because before this method, the idea what means chaotic is really very generic. It's something which is irregular, looking at the spectrum, looking at the correlation function. This is the borderline between the prehistory and the history of dynamical system. Before this, the dynamical system was a matter only for mathematicians. After this, it was possible even for us physicists entering the game, studying not just some very abstract theorem, just looking at what happened, just look at some number. Okay. And okay, this is for the part of the Lyapunov exponent. Now, the other aspect I mentioned yesterday is the characterization of the attractor. And I said yesterday that a way to characterize the attractor is there are a list of property of the Lyapunov exponent which I give you without any proof. Okay, so the conservative system, the sum of the Lyapunov exponent is zero. In Hamiltonian, in symplectic system, Hamiltonian, so symplectic system, we have that the last one, let me call lambda 2n, is minus lambda 1. This specular situation, okay? And in this dissipative system, the sum of the Lyapunov exponent is equal to the divergence, and so it's negative. For example, in the Lorentz model, so in the Lorentz model, or this is for the differential equation. Otherwise, it's the determinant of the matrix. And for example, in the case of the then there is another nice property, which in the case of for ordinary differential equation, apart the stupid case with fixed point, okay, if the system is just before this, if you have a stable fixed point, you have that all the Lyapunov exponents are negative. This is trivial, okay. If you have a stable limit cycle, you have that one Lyapunov exponent is zero, and the other are negative. But the interesting situation is when at least one is positive. So in the case of ordinary differential equation, at least. Apart the trivial case of stable fixed point, at least one Lyapunov exponent is exactly zero. Okay, this helps in the computation. For example, with this result, when you have to you can use this result, for example, in the NO map, you have two diapon exponents, the first and the second, but the second is fixed by this condition. In the Lorentz system, you have three diapon exponents, but only one is independent, because the first one, because the second must be zero, and the third is fixed by this condition. Okay, so this a lot. In low-dimensional system, this kind means that practically you have just one diapon exponent, because the other are trivially determined by this general condition. Okay, now, the structure of the attractor. Before to go on, let me, yesterday I discussed with one of you in a private forum, an important fact that what is the intuition, why you expect that in the dissipative chaotic system you have some strange attractor. Why? The reason is the following. This is associated to the stretching and folding mechanism. What is the stretching folding? So imagine that just to fix the idea, the NO map. Okay, so you have a dissipative system, which is chaotic, and live in a bounded domain. Okay, then you start with a set of initial conditions like this. Okay, so what happens? So because it is dissipative, this evolves, and this area must decrease. Okay, into this area, volume in general, must decrease. Okay, but can decrease in different way. For example, one possibility just to decrease in a trivial way, just decrease inside. But this is not possible, no? This is possible way to decrease, but this is possible only in stable situation, because in a stable situation, in chaotic situation, this is not possible, because if you take 2 points here, these 2 points, the distance must increase. So this is not possible. So what happens that this must become something like that? Why? Because if you take here just some point, the point and so on, the distance must increase. So this means that you have something like that. Okay. So because the system is dissipative, the area must decrease. But because it's chaotic, the shape is necessary some elongation. Okay. And then this mechanism must go on. Okay. So since it must be bounded in a finite region, in a finite domain, the only possibility. That not only you have this stretching, but there's also a folding. You have to fold this stuff in order to remain inside this stuff. So it's necessary something like that. Okay? It must be repeated all the time you want. So at the end, so you start from something like that, and then the end, it's necessary to have something like that. Okay. This infinite time. So this means that this cannot be a smooth stuff. It can be something. So you can hope that this is self-similar, for example. You can imagine that if I take this and I perform a zoom, I obtain the same. Okay, this is not a proof, of course, but so you can expect something like this. And the reason is this mechanism. The reason is that putting together the fact that this is put together, the fact that this is dissipative, it's chaotic, it is bounded. Putting these three things together, you have the intuition that you expect something like that. Okay. So this is the reason why you expect fractal. This is not a proof. Eh? Nobody has been able to prove that some attractor is really fractal. Huh? As far as I know, maybe there are some specific case, but it's what you expect and you find in numerical simulation. So I guess you are familiar with fractal. It's not necessary to define a fractal dimension. No, I have to find fractal dimension. Yes or not? I have to define. Okay. So what means fractal? So the real fractal, which if I say fractal, you expect to say that the father of fractal was Mandelbrot. Wrong. The father of fractal was not Mandelbrot, but was another gentleman. I suspect that you don't know the name of this guy. Do you know who was this guy? You know? So every day you see the weather forecasting program. If you see the weather forecasting program, it's because this way, this gentleman invented the modern methodology to perform the weather forecasting, among the other things. The famous question, how long is the coast of Great Britain, is from him, not from Mandelbrot. Okay, apart the historical remark, what means fractal? The idea is fractal is dimension. Yeah, measurements. What I mean, dimension. So usually I say, why you say that this is dimension one? You say this is dimension one because a point here is determined by one number, no? The longitudinal curvilinear coordinate. This is L1, this is L2, and that's it. So if you have I have a sphere. On the sphere, a point is identified by two numbers, latitude and longitude. No? So this is, you say this is dimension one, this is dimension two. So if you have a volume, it's dimension three because you need x, y, z, okay, and so on. So you associate the idea of dimension with discrete number in terms of the how many coordinates I need to identify a point. Okay, this is an idea. Another idea, which is say empirical, is due to Richardson, is the following. So imagine that you have a line. Imagine that I have a line, and you have a, come si chiama, compasso? Compasso? Okay, there is a compass. Okay, you have an instrument with a certain precision. Let me call delta x, okay? And you take your instrument, so yeah, this and this. So you approximate this as something with a segment of size delta x, okay? And then you count how many segments I need to cover this stuff, okay? I count this, and then I multiply by delta x, and I take the limit delta x go to zero, and this is what you call length, right? This is called what you call length. The length is one. So if you repeat the same game with the sphere, so you count how many square of edge delta x you need to cover this stuff, and this approach to what you call surface. Okay, in the case of the volume, you have n delta x cube, and this go to the volume. Okay, this is another way to define. So you see that here you have that. In this case, yeah. Delta x go like delta x to minus one. In this case, delta x to minus two, and here you have delta x to minus three. Say, this is another way to define dimension, because instead to say how many variable I need, blah blah, just from say, empirical point of view. I count how many
boxes.
Quantities, many element, as necessary to approximate this stuff in the limit of delta x go to zero. And I have that delta n delta x goes like delta x to minus d. I define the dimension in this way. I have to count, and counting, looking at the scaling, that's it, fine. But okay, in this way, I obtain what I know, 1, 2, 3. Up to now, not interesting. Now, the next question is it possible to have an object such that this quantity is not 1, 2, 3? Okay, this was the smart idea of Richard. So actually it was also some, in the prehistory of this stuff, Richardson is the father, but the grandfather probably was Weierstrass. Weierstrass in his work on Fourier series, non-differential Fourier series. So apart the historical aspect, so you can wonder if there exists situation where this number is something, for example, between 1 or 2 or 2 or 3, and so on. So and there are a lot. So just so what is important is that not only is possible to show some mathematical object such that this d is not integer, and this maybe you can say this is just mathematical curiosity. Who cares? Now the next step is this that exists in nature or not. This is important from physical point of view. So the first step is mathematics, and this is easy. I show you in 20 seconds. 2 minutes. The following step is there exists this stuff in a non-trivial way, for example, in chaotic attractor. We would say chaotic attractor is not very physical, it's just mathematics. Okay, you can wonder, if you look outside the window, I observe this stuff? Yes, in turbulence, for example. In turbulence, there is the energy distribution of turbulence is an horrible object, which is not a fractal, but it's more complicated. It's called multifractal, but don't worry. So now let me just show you a situation where this is not one. Oh, so in the paper, how is long the coast of Great Britain, this gentleman perform explicitly this exercise, okay? On the maps, of course, not working along the coast. And plotting log of n log of delta x, put the number, and you observe that this slope, you observe that d was not one, but was something like, I don't remember, 1.2, 1.3, so, but however, something for sure different from one. So why? So this means that in some sense the curve is not differentiable, because it's differentiable, this is one. Okay, at least it's not differentiable at a certain scale. Okay. Now let me just show an example of fractal, the von Koch curve. So the von Koch curve is the following. It's very simple. You can construct it in an iterative way. So at the steps zero, you have a segment of size one, okay? Zero, one. At the step one, you divide this segment in three parts. You remove the internal part and you substitute with two other parts. Okay, this is one, this is 1/3, and then you repeat again. And repeat again. It's enough, it's not good. you go on, okay. This is 1/3, this is 1/3 square. And so on. Okay, you see that delta x here is one, is 1/3, is 1/9, and n here is 1, here is 4, here is 16. Okay, and if you go on at the scale 1/3 to n. Here you have 4 to n. Okay, so now if you want to measure to compute the, so you have a non-differentiable curve, of course. And so, and then if you apply this formula, what you have that n of 1/3 to n is equal to 4 to n. Okay, then you apply this formula and you obtain that d is this, this is log of 4 log of 4 log of 3, which is something between 2 and 1. Okay, is a number. So okay, so you see, this is an example. Okay, you can say, oh, okay, this is a pathological, it's an artificial example. Yes, you are all the right to say that this is just a joke, this is just a game. Okay. But if the fractal remain on this level are not important, no? But fortunately, they appear in a non-trivial way, okay? So, okay, this is the way to compute the dimension. And the problem is that, okay, but if I, for example, if I have empirically an attractor, imagine that now you have your computer, you iterate a system, for example, the a new map or Lorentz system, and you want so, and you assume because you expect, you hope that the attractor is a fractal. The first question is how you computed the fractal dimension. How you compute the fractal dimension? Okay, these things was very popular when I have your age, in the 80s. And the first approach was very, very, very naive. Was just the first approach is just to apply the definition, of course. Okay, the first approach is what is called box counting. So just to repeat this, so the idea is the following. So this is the first method. Of course, the first method is not efficient as usual. However, it's the first method, box counting. Box counting is the following. Imagine that you have your system and you generate x1, x2, xn. So this is the point evolving time, okay? Imagine that the time is discrete, is continuous, you take it at a certain tau, it's not important. Okay, you have this point. For example, and then you have your system, and you perform a partition of your system. Of size, so say epsilon. So you have this point, okay? You have this point. Well, n is very large, of course, and n must be very large. You have this point, and at a given epsilon, you count how many non-empty boxes you have. So you count how many non-empty boxes you have. Let you call this n of epsilon. Okay, then if this is a fractal, means that this is scaling this way. Okay, so now you take this, you put here log epsilon, you repeat the game with the different epsilon, small, you have point. So, and if this is fractal, this point will be on the line. If it's fractal, and if on the line, you do a fit, and from this fit you have the diffusion. Okay, this is the method. This method is pretty stupid because it's just a definition, just the application definition. And the question is, the method is efficient? No, of course, no, it's not efficient. So it's efficient for the annual map. For the annual map, it's efficient because if you do this for the annual map, for example, the annual map with b equals 0.3. A equal 1.4, which is the typical value, just to play, the dimension is is around 1.26. Okay. So, and if you look at you perform a zoom of the attractor, you realize that actually there is a self-similar structure. Okay, but this is simple. Exactly. Okay, if you zoom this stuff, if you zoom here, you see that you have more. Se c'hai, scusa, il mio libro sotto mano, ci metti la figura? C'è il mio libro? Vabbè. Oh, ben, fa niente. Allora, so if you do this is the neural map, okay? So if you do the same for the Lorentz system, with R equal 28, here you have the D is around 2.05, okay? So of course, in the case of low dimensional system, the method is okay. But so you see, the method is very it's stupid because for example in 2D this is non-empty, this is the non-empty box, but the total number of boxes is much larger, is epsilon 2 minus 2. Okay, so this means when you do this, many of the boxes are empty, so you have an enormous memory consuming for nothing. Okay, and so it's clear that this method cannot be applied to large system. Even something embedded in a system with the dimension with the five variable, the method is not efficient. You realize immediately. Okay, and so the work who solved the problem, at least not completely, but at least so this is the first step. Is the Grasberger Procaccia method. If I remember correctly, it was 83. Okay. The idea of Grasberger Procaccia method is to avoid to have a method which is efficient and is not limited by the fact that you had to use an enormous number of boxes and all these boxes are empty, okay? And the idea is the following. Actually in this way, the method is not, the method doesn't allow to compute the fractal dimension, but another dimension, which apparently is disturbing because you want to compute the fractal dimension, but what you compute is something different. And you can complain on this, but it's not true. So maybe this is the point for a break, Matteo. Okay. They allow the computation of another dimension, and then after this, the people realize that the fractal dimension is just one dimension, it's not the dimension. So it's possible to introduce many dimensions, infinite dimension, and the fractal dimension in some sense is not the most relevant. Even the dimension introduced by Grasberger Procaccia is not the most relevant, but in any case, better than nothing. So and generalizing, so this is the first step, and this is the what's called correlation dimension, and then so. Generalize Grasberger Procaccia method, we have it's possible to compute generalized dimension. The name is Rennie dimension. And there exists a thermodynamic interpretation of this dimension. There's a thermodynamic. It sounds strange, thermodynamics. Thermodynamics, what means thermodynamics for the Enron map? It sounds ridiculous. No, but I show you that. Okay, so you see, this is the. You see, when you repeat, you appear this Okay, this is not a proof that it's self-similar, but it is rather convincing that you suspect that this is really self-similar, okay? And actually, it's not exactly self-similar. So the fact that when you try to generalize the idea, you realize that there is no a unique dimension, and this dimension has been interpreted in terms of statistical mechanics formalism. So apparently, say, so you know the usual statistical thermodynamic formula, the free energy and so on. Z, what is it? The partition function. A partition function and so on. What is the relation of partition function and free energy, this stuff? No, there is a connection. There is a connection. I show you in the next hour. I stop here.
Okay, and, we take a break.
Do you have some questions?
Questions? No, okay. Break. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay. The idea of Grassberg-Procaccia is very simple, but as usual, when you know, it's simple. And the idea is the following. So you start with, you have x1, xn, okay? N, very large, okay? So this is the point which, when you run on your computer, you remove the first transient and take this, okay? And these are representative of the attractor. And you want to understand something like a dimension. Okay. The idea is the following. I take one point, xi, and I take a ball of size epsilon, and I count how many of this stuff are inside this. Okay. So, and then I perform an average on all the time. So this means this, I take, so in order to count, I can count, I take the theta function, the epsilon minus xi minus xj. So this is zero if the distance is larger than epsilon, and this one if the distance is smaller than epsilon. So this count how many couple as distance less than epsilon. Then I take the average I and j and divide by n square. Okay, n square, n minus n minus one over two, but that is who cares, okay? Let me say n square and so on. And so, and now, you, and then I take epsilon small, and the statement is this, when epsilon go to is small, this is epsilon to something, and let me call something d2. And so you expect that this d2 is some relation with the fractal dimension. Actually, it's not exactly, but why? Imagine that, why you expect this, why you expect this is the dimension. Imagine that you have, that the point are on a line. If the point are on a line and you perform this, it's clear that what you obtain epsilon. No? And if the point are on a two-dimensional surface, you are epsilon square. And if you are on volume, you are, okay. So for the same reasoning, you say this is a dimension, okay? And you expect that this dimension has some relation with the fractal dimension. Actually, it's possible to prove that T2 is a lower bound, is the dimension is surely smaller or equal to, well, before to go on, why this method is smart? Apart that this is not exactly this, but almost. For example, if you compute this in for the Enron map, instead of 1.26, you obtain 1.24. So it's almost impossible to distinguish, but this is just a coincidence. Huh? Well, apart this, so this method is much powerful than the box counting method because it's not necessary to introduce a partition. No? You don't introduce any partition. And what is important at the end of the story, that this dimension is not too large, but the original dimensions, let me call x I in R to, let me call d, small d. So this d here can be also large, maybe 5 or 6, who care? What is important is that this number here is not too big. Okay, so if this is large, the box counting method is practically impossible. Okay, this is just at a computational level. So the computational level, this was a great advantage for the method. And then the people started to understand that it's so important that this is smaller than what means that is smaller, what is the relevance of the difference between D2 and D and so on, okay? Okay, and this is the story of the, this is the next step. The next step, the introduction of the Rank dimension and what is called multifractal description. The multifractal description of this object has been introduced in around 1984 in Rome and Chicago. And I present the Chicago version, just to be kind, because I was in the other group, whatever. And okay, the two leaders was one was Parisi in Rome, and in Chicago was Kadanoff. And the idea is just posteriori. So the approach is the following: in mathematical term, you have the problem of the characterization of a singular measure. Okay, so mathematically you have this problem. You have a measure, let me call mu, d mu of x, which is singular. Singular means that this is not possible to write in this way. Not possible to write in this way where this is a smooth function. Okay. And so you want to characterize how this is singular, in which sense it's singular, and so on. Okay. So the idea is very simple. Very simple. The idea is the following. And you have your system, and I present a simplified version, so it's possible also to do something more sophisticated, but so it's not very important. You introduce a partition epsilon, regular. You can also non-regular partition, but don't worry. You introduce an epsilon partition, and you have this cell. You numerate this cell. And so this is, for example, the cell I. And you introduce, so you have a resolution epsilon, and you let me call pi epsilon the probability to stay here. So the integral of this stuff on this cell. So this is lambda I epsilon is the cell of size epsilon center in this point. Okay, now what happened? So if the system is regular, in the case of regular, if it's irregular, in the case regular, regular means that you have d mu equal rho dx. If it is irregular, this quantity is just epsilon to the dimension of your system, apart the prefactor, 2, 3, 4, and that's it. Maybe there is a prefactor here due to the, but the scaling is epsilon. So this is regular, okay? It's regular, and you have always the same d, and which is the trivial d. Now, the problem is that to put in evidence the irregular, the singularity, and the idea is the following, and to perform a sort of partition function. The terminology is exactly the statistical mechanics argument. It's not a coincidence that the Parisian Kalanoff had some knowledge of statistical mechanics. And so the, let me call Z epsilon Q, okay? Defined this way, defined as sum or I of P I epsilon Q, where Q is a number, not necessarily integer, okay? So, and then you look at the scaling of this scaling of this quantity for small epsilon. And okay, this is the definition, and this epsilon go to Q minus one dQ. Okay, you define this number, you define this number. These are called Reni dimension. Reni dimension is in honor of Alfred Reni, who was a great Hungarian mathematician. I guess he never introduced this stuff, but so in honor of him, these are called. He introduced something similar in information theory, but the idea is the same. Now, these are the generalization. So it's simple to see that if I take Q equals zero, okay, this quantity is zero if this empty or one is non-empty. So if I take Q equals zero, I have that the D zero is the fractal dimension. Okay, then okay, it's possible to prove that, don't worry. So it's possible to prove that if you take Q equal two, I obtain T of two is the Grasberger dimension, the D Grasberger Procaccia dimension, okay? And so it's possible to prove that this quantity must be a non-increasing quantity. This is just a standard inequality in probability. It's a convexity argument. Okay, D of Q is monotonic, non-increasing. Okay, and monotonic non-increasing. And so now, what happened? That the shape of DOQ is important to understand the how this structure, how this fractal is trivial or not. Okay, the imagine that you have a simple fractal. Simple means that is the density of the point are homogeneous on the fractal, okay? So in the homogeneous fractal, the homogeneous fractal, you have that D of Q is equal to the fractal dimension. So this is a flat stuff, okay? Something, let's say, uniformly distributed in some sense. The fact that if this is not true, this means that you have a hierarchical, you have inhomogeneity on the fractal of the measure. So you see that we start to define a fractal as an object, but in mathematical term, the fractal is not an object, it's something related to a measure. Okay, so in order to characterize in an interesting way, you have to look in terms of the measure. Then you can wonder, with this definition, you are forced to use the partition. Don't worry, there is a trick to avoid the partition. At numerical level, it's possible to avoid this is just a definition, but so it's possible to introduce a trick to repeating the idea of Grasberger Procaccia for a generic, let me write the trick. The trick is the following, so just for to be complete. So the idea, the generalization of the Grasberger Procaccia method, you define this quantity, you count sort of local density so this way you avoid the box counting, and then if you perform if you compute the 1 over n sum of I n I epsilon 2q, It's not difficult to prove that this scale has what? As Q D plus 1. So this is the definition, and this is the practical computational method. Okay, so now you can wonder, but there are all these dimensions. Are all these dimensions at the same level? Are conceptually and technically the same relevance? No, there is one dimension, which is the dimension, the most important dimension. The most important dimension is not D2, is not D0, is D1. Why? Is this one? And the fact that this is one, this is called information dimension, and is associated to the entropy, okay? Why? The important dimension is D1. This is one, and this is called the information dimension. Why? Take this stuff. Let me take Q equal 1 plus epsilon, something small, okay. Epsilon tilde. I use epsilon for the epsilon tilde small. Okay, and then from this, I take this stuff, and I have that Q minus 1 DOQ is limit epsilon go to 0 of what? Of log of some pi epsilon to Q divide by Q minus 1. No, divide log of epsilon, okay? This is the proper mathematical definition. Okay, then let me take Q equal 1 plus epsilon tilde. And I have that P I epsilon to Q is equal to P I epsilon, P I epsilon to epsilon tilde. Let me remind the trick. Let me look at the trick. It's a simple trick, but I have to far to remind the trick. See, okay. So using the standard trick in statistical mechanics, let me write this as exponential of epsilon tilde log of p, which is sure is correct. Apparently stupid, but it's not stupid. And then let's see, I use the fact that this is small. So we have pi 1 plus epsilon tilde log pi. Okay, so we have that sum of pi q is equal to sum pi plus epsilon tilde sum pi log pi. This is one by definition. So one plus epsilon tilde sum I pi log pi. So now start to appear something interesting. Okay. Now I have to take the logarithm of this stuff. The logarithm of this, I have to take the logarithm of this. But the logarithm of this by definition, so the logarithm of one plus something small. Okay. So I have that the log of some pi 1 plus epsilon tilde is equal to 1, no, to this stuff, to epsilon tilde, sum of pi log pi. And I can go on. So if you want something more, but at this step, at this level is enough. This. So I have this. And then I am okay, because now Now I have here at Q is equal to 1 plus epsilon tilde. Okay, so this is epsilon tilde, d1 plus epsilon tilde equal to what? To limit epsilon go to zero. Oh, what? Here I have qui, questo qui, epsilon tilde, sum I pi log pi over log epsilon, okay? And I take the limit epsilon tilde go to zero, and I have the t1, I have the definition, a way to define d1 is necessary to do this, because otherwise d1 is defined this way, epsilon go to zero as the sum of I pi log pi epsilon, log epsilon. Okay, now if you put here minus, this is a sort of entropy. No, this is an entropy. This is an entropy of let me put minus here. Okay, and I have that minus sum of I pi epsilon log pi epsilon is minus d1 log of epsilon. No, now you don't, in order to see let me write another way, let me go. This is d1 log 1 over epsilon, or log 1 over epsilon d1. Let me write this way. So if you write this way, you can appreciate. So this is, what is this? This is the entropy. The entropy with the resolution epsilon. Yeah, the epsilon, this is the resolution epsilon, is equal to log 1 over epsilon to d1. So now you understand why this is the dimension. No, because you have a system uniformly distributed. You have that this is the log of the volume, and the volume is the size to the dimension. Okay, so this is okay, it's one, because, and this is in the scale unit. Okay, so you see that d1 is associated to an entropy. Okay, and no, this is possible to prove, believe me, that if you pick a point on the attractor at random with the measure, natural measure, and if you look at the ball around this point and you wonder what is the probability to stay there, how scale the probability, you realize that the probability scale as epsilon to d1. So this is the most probable singularity. So you have infinite singularity, but at the end of the story, this is the most possible. So and this is can be computed, because you can be computed, you know, using this formula here. You repeat the game and you take the logarithm, blah blah blah. So using with the same idea, you performing the average of log of n, you can compute this stuff. So this can be computed. So it's a bit longer and so on. Not only can be computed, but if you go on here in the computation, considering also the next order, what you have, if you go on, you have that d of q per q around 1 is equal to d1 minus something, let me call sigma square, q minus 1. Okay. So I am considering the correction to this one. This sigma 1 is really a fluctuation of something, okay? And so you see that it's true that the d of q is something like that, because it is a non-decreasing function, so something like that, okay? But what is really important is this value and this slope. And this slope here. So this slope, which is given by this sigma, must be negative, because This slope gives you an idea how inhomogeneous is the fractal. So if this is small, you are almost homogeneous, we have something like that. No? Yeah, something like. So this is very, very flat. Okay, so this is I promise you that there is a thermodynamic interpretation of all this stuff.
Angelo, one question. So there are other ways in which you could define a dimension. Say, for example, you could define a dimension.
Yeah.
Okay. So, for example, there is a spectral dimension. So, if you look at
dimension is another story. The spectral
diffusion, is the spectral dimension related to any
of this? No. The spectral dimension is another story because this is about static stuff. This study is talking about the attractor. The fractal dimension is associated with the diffusion property. It's a concept that is different because all this stuff you have to work in a finite domain. Why the fractal dimension is associated to the diffusion property, which is an open space, an open domain. No, there is no, in general, there is no trivial. As far as I know, there is no connection. No. Yeah, it's true that also in different cases, there are different dimensions, but here there are infinite dimensions. Okay, this is a continuous spectrum. So now I promise you the thermodynamic interpretation of this stuff. The thermodynamic interpretation is I never discussed with Kaldanov and Parisi how they arrive to this work. Now it's impossible to discuss with Kaldanov because he is no more with us, but also with Parisi is not simple to speak. This is my personal reconstruction of the origin of the idea. It's personal reconstruction. I don't know if they had this idea or not. My personal reconstruction is the following. Imagine that you have the standard, you compute the system with n particle, you compute the partition function, is something like that. No? You have to compute this. Okay. Better. So, a standard trick is instead to compute this stuff, you connect with the microcanonical property. Right? So, you define omega. Okay, you have n go very large. So you expect that the energy, you write the energy as n times the energy for particle, and you write that the and the microcanonical entropy, you write as n times the microcanonical entropy for particle, something like that, okay? And you write this, you write this way. Huh? Okay. This is just a change of variable, introducing the density of states. Okay, so you remember this is exponential of. Okay, forget the Boltzmann constant just for simplicity, and this is n s. Yeah, this stuff. Okay, so you. So this is exponential n s epsilon, and here you have minor beta epsilon. You have this stuff, okay? But this just shift the problem, okay? So of course this is not easy to compute, but imagine that so if you do this, then okay, this is behave like exponential of minus beta n f, where this is the free energy for particle, okay? Now, immediately you realize that, let me put here let me line this, okay? So, no. L'ho scritto bene? No. Sì. So you see that you compare this with this. So since you are interested in the limit very large n, you can perform a Laplace method, said Laplace computation, and what you have that beta f of t is the minimum on A of beta epsilon minus s. We have this computation, okay? So you see that you can write the free energy in terms of a Lejeune transform of the entropy, the microcanonical entropy. Okay. Now, what is important here is the entropy. The entropy is the counter. Count how many states you have such that. Now repeat the game. Yeah. Now, if you have to repeat the game using this trick. So in this trick, you put together all the part of the phase space such that you have a certain energy, and you count how many you have. Now the idea is the following: I look at the point such that you have that this go as epsilon to alpha. This in some sense is similar that you look at the region where this you have a certain energy. And the analogous of this, you have to count how many boxes you have such that you have alpha. So I count how many boxes of size epsilon present this scaling. So this is what? So here this is an entropy. This is associated. So if I count how many boxes such that I am introducing a fractal dimension. So this means that I have epsilon 2 minus something. This something is called f of alpha. Okay, it's not this f, so sorry. Well, this is just Chicago, they call it f, okay? And so I introduce, so this is in some sense, you see that alpha is somehow analogous of energy. And f of alpha is the analogous of entropy. And the fact that n go to infinite is the analogous of epsilon go to zero, which allow to perform a saddle point. Okay, this is the analogy. So the asymptotic correspond to small epsilon. And so with this stuff, so you have that. Now you repeat the game. Yeah, this is integral of what? Of epsilon to q alpha minus f of alpha d alpha. Okay, apart some decoration. Okay, so now you repeat the game. So you have that you are interested in the limit small epsilon. So in the limit small epsilon, this means that the dominant is given by the minimum. So you have this epsilon go to minimum on alpha q alpha minus f of alpha. But this by definition is q minus one. So you have this dq is equal 1 q minus 1, the minimum on alpha, with alpha q minus f of alpha, which is a Lejeune transform. You see that there is a perfect parallelism with this. So this is the reason why the mathematician called this thermodynamic formalism. It's thermodynamic form because at a formal level, so you have that Q in some sense is analogous of the temperature of beta, no? And and so on. So you see that here, when you change temperature, you perform an inspection of the phase space. If beta is very large, you don't see nothing. So if beta is small, you don't see nothing. When you change the temperature, at the varying the temperature, you explore different. So here is the same. So at the varying Q, you are able to explore the singularity. So if you want to see the very strong singularity, which corresponds to small value of Q, to small value of alpha, you have to look at very large Q. Very large Q give you an idea of the terrible event, very, very similar, okay? And so on. Okay, this is the idea. So of course, this F of alpha cannot be a completely arbitrary function, as the entropy is not an arbitrary function. So you remember the entropy must be convex for some reason, even here for some very good reason, mathematical reason, F of alpha must be convex. The derivative must be negative, okay? And so now let me just, so the F of alpha must have some property. F of alpha must be, okay, let me, if this is, F of alpha must be something like that, okay? F of alpha must be surely smaller or equal than alpha. And there exists a point, alpha star, there exists a point alpha star such that F of alpha star is equal F star. And this is the important dimension. Important dimension, okay? And around this part, F of alpha behave like F of alpha star minus alpha minus alpha star square over two sigma square, which is the sigma square I introduced before, and so on. Okay, you have a parabolic shape. The parabolic shape is not a Gaussian approximation, so translate in a proper way. And okay, you have all this, it must be convex, F second must be negative. Okay, and of course the maximum is given by the fractal dimension. The maximum is given by the fractal dimension. And all this stuff can be measured. Not so simple, but and then, okay, so you take your attractor and you perform all this stuff. So then this for the attractor. So then you can wonder, okay, but this the attractor of the Lorentz system. We are physicists. Who care about the attractor of the Lorentz system? So it's possible to have some property using this kind of formula in real physics. The answer is yes. So in turbulence, so of course, I have no time to introduce you the problem of turbulence, but believe me, what is the singular measure of turbulence? In turbulence, what is important for some good reason is what is called energy dissipation. So apart from some decoration, so you look at the epsilon, the derivative, the I am not sure of the detail, but something like that. Ij derivative of ij plus square. So this is by definition is a positive quantity. Let me call this epsilon. No, it's not the same epsilon, okay. This is energy dissipation. Energy dissipation in the point x, of course, must be a non-negative function, and so you can take as measure. This is the measure. Okay, this is the measure. It's apart the mu of x, apart a constant to normalize is this one. Okay. And so what you have that the structure of this is. This stuff, which is why there are some very good reasons to study this. Andrei Nikolaevich Kolmogorov explained us that this is important stuff. And if you look at the this stuff, you observe multifractal. Oh, this story is called multifractal. Multifractal, why? Because it's not because there are different fractal embedded in superposed in for to explain that.
So I have a question. So can you really interpret this construction in this way, in the sense that it's like you have say different fractals with different singular, so the different singularity are really placed. So in the sense that if you take a point,
no,
and then you ask yourself
with, in some sense, but not. I can give you a trivial situation, but the actually the situation is much more complicated. Okay, so the trivial situation is as you are saying. Okay, but for example, the simple situation is that what you call bifractal. So imagine that you have that the attractor is a line, the points are distributed on a line, and then are also distributed on the surface. Okay. Then if I take here, I observe that the P scale like epsilon. If I take here, I have that P scale like epsilon square. Okay. So if I perform this computation, what you observe? I observe this or this depend on the value of I have something like that, and then the OQ BL in this way, which is a bit stupid. Okay, so this is just to have an intuition. So you have to imagine we have a superposition infinite this stuff in such a way you have the smooth curve. I don't know if this was defined. So this is just to develop intuition. So this is a big fractal. So you have this and this.
So the question is the converse, no? Whenever you find a fractal, a multifractal structure, can you always interpret it as local singularities?
Yeah, in some sense, yes, but not too much, because this is considered this as a probabilistic interpretation. So, because if you wonder what happens if you look at a certain point with probability one, you obtain the one. That's it. No, sorry. It's not, if you try to obtain something different from one, it's possible because you have zero measure. And so you have to consider in this way, just performing an average and so on. If you just try to take a point and consider the quantity point you have in a certain ball, there is a general theorem. You say this you obtain D1. That's it. This is the reason why D1 is considered the dimension. The dimension, because if you take a point at random in the sense of, you obtain the one. And the fact that you obtain something different because you perform an average and you take the average and the average, you are weighting the point in different way because there are this Q. This is the reason. So in some sense, the correct average is when Q is close to one, which corresponds to entropy. And so this is, for me, my point of view is very nice because it is a perfect correspondence between the statistical mechanics formulas and this stuff.
Why? I understand, but say, is there a way to tilt the probability in such a way that you can sample rare points, whichever.
No, you sample the rare point this way. You sample rare point this way. So you know that performing this study with different Q, you realize that there are these rare points. But rare point you can observe directly, because if you try to observe a rare point, systematically you take a typical point. This is the trick. Okay, I guess we can stop. And so tomorrow I finish the tomorrow is the last day, no? Part.
Yes, tomorrow is the last lecture.
Okay. Tomorrow I have to discuss a point before to pass to change argument. I have to discuss the connection between the dimension and the Lyapunov exponent, because apparently, say, I have a Lyapunov exponent from a side and the dimension on the other, and apparently are two disconnected chapters of the book. And no, it's not true. There is a connection. This is very important. Let me finish. The problem is the following. If you try to compute the dimension, don't worry which dimension, let me call the Grasberger dimension, care, okay? Of course, the method has a limit, The limit is when the dimension is large, it's not possible to use the method. Large means 4, 5, or 6. Why? Because you are trying to fill a high-dimensional space. If you try to fill a high-dimensional space, you need an astonishing number of points. Okay, so imagine that you want to fill a segment. A segment with 100 points is enough. A segment, you need 10 to 4. In 3D, you have 10 to 6, and so on. If you want to fill a system with dimension 10, with the same precision, you need 10 to 20, which is out of your possibility. So you can wonder, how is possible to compute the fractal dimension of an attractor in a system with the dimension is around 20? It's not possible to do with this method. It's clear, it's not possible. You realize immediately. Maybe 10 is possible, but 20 for sure is not possible. So, but there are a lot of systems whose dimension is large. It's not 2 or 3, maybe it's 100. So how can compute the fractal dimension of the system with the 100? Ah, okay. The first point is why? Why you want to compute the fractal dimension of the system, which is 100? Why is it important? For example, in turbulence, so in atmospheric science, why you want to understand? So the reason is the following. The dimension, apart the integer part, the dimension attractor give you an idea of how many relevant variables you need in principle. So imagine that you are a system with 10 to 5 variables, but the dimension is only 22. Okay? Then the conclusion is that maybe in the future, some smart mathematician will give us the proper 22 variable, or maybe 23, so just, okay, no? Oh, this is the idea. And this is the reason why, so the effective dimension is given by the fractal dimension of the attractor, not by the dimension of the nominal dimension. But how you can compute? Not with this method. With this method, it's impossible, it's clear. Fortunately, there is a formula. Actually, there is no proof, there is only conjecture that put a relation between the Lyapunov exponent and the fractal dimension. The Lyapunov exponent, there is no problem at the computational level. If you want to compute the fractal, the Lyapunov exponent of a system with 2000 variable, you can do. When I was young, also with Stefano Ruffo, we compute a system like system with 100 variable, and this was almost 40 years ago. Now is absolutely straightforward. So Lyapunov exponent are not difficult to compute all the Lyapunov exponent you want, even some thousand. Now the point is, knowing the Lyapunov exponent, is possible to understand something about the dimension. At the level of theorem, no. But at the level of acceptable argument, yes. There is a conjecture, it's called Capran-York conjecture, which put relation between these two fields. And this is the reason why the Lyapunov exponents are important. Not who cares if Lyapunov exponent is 1.2 or 1.3. Okay, it's important to have is 1 or 10. Okay, and what is the relevance of the other, the second, and so on? Okay, the mathematical, yeah, this and this, how close the area, and so on. But at the end, who cares how close the area? At the physical level, what's important is the first one. But then what's important are all the Lyapunov exponents together to try to understand the fractal dimension of the attractor. Actually, there is no proof of this, but I guess everybody believe that this is the essence is true. In any case, it is not possible. So in the case where you can check independently, it works in low dimension, and so you hope that is correct. Okay. But in any case, this is the only possibility. In fact, the people invent an extra name called Kaplan-York dimension. Kaplan-York dimension is a dimension assuming that this conjecture is true, okay. And then which is tautological. Okay, but everybody believe. Even great theoretician, even very sophisticated mathematician, like even Sinai believed that is true. Okay, if Sinai believed it's true, it must be true. Okay, see you tomorrow.
Okay, thank you very much. So we meet tomorrow.
intendevo io era la seconda cosa. Alla fine, diciamo,